Card Zero, Echoes of the 99, by August Servant, Volume 1. Lecture number 3. United, we are worthy. I will always hold firm to my belief that good is stronger than evil, due to the fact that it takes far more energy, effort, and power to lift something up than it does to push it down. Now then, contrary to popular belief, it takes a powerful person to lift someone's spirit. And isn't that exactly what goodness does? Good lifts, good rises, good builds, even as evil in its envy seeks to erase all that good leaves behind in its wake. What I see is that inside every virtue of God is a wellspring of strength and power just waiting to be tapped by right thinking and a positive attitude. Right thinking sees only one direction, like a horse with blinders on that cannot be swayed from its course. And it is your attitude that will determine your altitude, as positivity contributes all the thrust necessary to carry you up and over. What I see is that good fortifies and enhances everything it touches by supporting not only the physical, but the mental, moral, and spiritual as well, leaving the recipient so full of gratitude that all thoughts of fatigue and doubt melt away as a snowflake before a persistent sun. Now I must ask you, is a snowflake greater than the sun? And it is in this analogy that we can plainly see that evil contributes nothing and is actually a folding in of energy, thereby causing our internal power structure to collapse in upon itself, leaving us with nothing to draw upon. With the moral here being that evil only seeks to drain you of your life force. And does that not beg the question of how can the parasite be greater than the host on which it feeds? It is a moral imperative that we understand that evil is empty and takes all of its strength solely from the fear and ignorance of its host, victim, and those entranced by it. With the takeaway here being twofold. One, your actions are charged by your intent, for that is the power backing them. And second, everything comes through you, not to you. Need I remind you that God can only do for us what he can do through us? The power in goodness. The most potent energy released by man is channeled through goodwill. Jesus was the most prolific miracle worker of all time. This we know. But have you considered that all of his great works were both charged and commissioned by his intent to serve and do only good? You see, faith is only the effect. But the cause backing it, feeding all of its power and potency, is not God, but goodness. For that is the measure backing the desire. Exactly when did the act of simply living become so hard? Perhaps the answer is, we have become accustomed to getting rewarded so much in life that we have lost the enthusiasm, motivation, and ambition to do anything great for ourselves unless it has a carrot dangling at the end of its rope. But is this the result of evil or plain old-fashioned laziness? Maybe we would not be so reluctant to dream big if we had an idea of what we were truly capable of. Where most are capable, few are able. Thus, this is not a question of ability, but desire. What do you mean? Where being capable signifies that it's possible. Ability is contingent on enthusiasm and willpower, which are both measures of desire, which is to say, how bad do you want it? Now then, we all do what we do for the same reasons, pleasure or peace in the short term, from which we believe will bring us happiness in the long run. And when we don't have what we want, the determined or able can take solace in the sacrifice as they trade discipline for immediate gratification. And it is for this reason that sacrifice is the measure of maturity, for it is in witnessing the measure of a determined will that we can gauge the level of responsibility that someone can be entrusted with. Now, here is something to consider. It is just as impossible for man to touch the ceiling of the sky as it is for him to embody all of the principles of God. True enough. But just as man has learned to jump, climb, and fly, it is with equal hope that he may grow within himself to uphold a measure of God's holy precepts, one virtue at a time. And before you say, what is the point in pursuing lofty goals and impossible dreams? My question to you is this. Is not the heartfelt desire, anticipation, and enthusiasm its own reward? Listen, if you don't know, it is the chase that we live for that fills us up to bursting, not the capture. Because a body at rest does not produce the same pleasure hormones as a body in motion. Now, the high that once came to us so easily in the pursuit is only a promise left to be fulfilled by that which we have attained. And when has our expectations ever been spot on? For the able, the promise alone is enough. Just as the mule will never taste a carrot dangling in front of its nose, the dog will never catch its tail, and God bless him for never realizing it. For in those moments, in the very act of stretching and striving, there is where you truly taste life. And although the immediate goal of the mule and the dog will always remain out of reach, neither are they standing in the same spot from which they began. Meaning that the energy generated in the cause or the chase is real. And that power flowing through them, charging every cell in their body with vigor and enthusiasm, is not only life, but the very hand of God pushing them ever forward towards a grace that they can't even see coming. Because their focus is so all-encompassing that the end result almost seems to come to them effortlessly, as if meeting them halfway. And it is in this way that if we would but only keep our minds centered on the benefit of the collective as a whole, that the momentum generated by our inspiration would do the rest. The power in the collective. There is nothing more fulfilling than a job well done, or no words as sweet as the praise of others. Therefore, it is fellowship that allows us to flex our mental prowess in an environment conducive of development and growth. Whereas a divided people with a divided mind can do nothing but continue to separate, only to die alone. Nature teaches us that to plant the naked seed is to bury it in its own grave. But to plant the whole fruit the way she does it is to seal it up in the womb of the earth with everything that it needs to someday grow and wax strong. When will we finally get it that one man alone is as a drop of water before the sun? Yet one man united with his people gives the sun a reason to shine and everything under it a purpose to live. And if that doesn't sound like the actions of a God, then maybe it will at least qualify as the works of his Son. With the moral here being, only together are we worthy. Lastly, most of us, we got it backwards. It is actually God that awaits our command. And only very few of us know this to be true. Isaiah 45:11, concerning the works of my hands, command ye me. Infinite intelligence, or God, is ever ready to carry out man's smallest or greatest demands. Every desire, uttered or unexpressed, is a demand. Our part is simply to hold true and faithful through to manifestation. Selah. The Warrior's Creed. The warrior that does not respect his weapon usually succumbs to it by fate. Anything created for a purpose is possessed of a measure of spirit, a knowing, independent of the user. And the more the tool or weapon is used with respect by the wielder, the more the two spirits become one, where the two are possessed of a shared awareness, wanting nothing more than to add to the greatness of the other. As a physician or craftsman has ever ready their implements and tools required for cases in need of their skill and expertise, so should a man have his principles ever ready towards the understanding of those things both divine and human at the forefront of his mind. My creed. Loyalty over life permits safe passage. I am as faithful as the difference between right and wrong, and as loyal as the difference between life and death. I am two in one to say that I am two separate beings residing in one physical human vessel. And in being as such, I will never be alone again, for I carry with me always my strength, my God, and my light. Dialogue. As a general rule, I don't make plans with strangers, because commitment comes with a cost, and frankly, I have no way of knowing what their word is worth. Dude! It's not that serious. And I thank you for making my point for me. You see, principles matter. Because believe it or not, a person's word is a form of currency. And if you haven't figured it out yet, security is measured by the number of promises kept. Scripture. 1. Job 41:16, where one is so near to another that no air can come between them. 2. Proverbs 4:23. Keep thy heart or imagination with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. And what this means is that what a man images sooner or later expresses in his affairs, and a person with an imaging faculty trained to image only good brings into his life every righteous desire of his heart. Health, wealth, love, friends, perfect self-expression, to say, his highest ideals. I submit to you, be worthy. Please allow me to introduce myself. You can call me August Servant, and it is a privilege to bring to you my captured Echoes of the 99 by way of
card zero, the Fool.